Do you know most of the people that are playing?
No, I didn't know any of them. But this is the first venture of its kind in the world. First one like this in the world that we've ever had.
The statue of Tom Scribner. Thomas Jefferson Scribner is found at the Musical Saw Festival, and it continues tomorrow.
What you gonna do when you're old and gray, honey? What you gonna do when you're old and gray, babe?
Around 78, a statue was made of Tom Scribner. And so there was an interest in getting it cast, but there wasn't much money around to do that.
Margie McMahon, a student up at UCSC, decided as her sculpture project to make a statue of Tom. The statue of bronze to cast cost $4,000. We didn't have that kind of money. So Tom said, let's put on a Saw Festival.
And so the idea came up of putting together a musical saw festival, and Tom had inspired so many people over the years to play musical saw, and inviting all the people connected with him to Santa Cruz. And they put on a big event at a downtown theater, sold tickets, and used it to raise money for casting the statue, which is now down on Pacific Street.
So we put on the very first musical saw festival, and it was inundated with all kinds of saw players from all over the world. There's a few very unusual saw players who practice only one genre. We have many gospel saw players. But Gordon Mumma used to be a professor up at UCSC. His is more electronic, atonal music. And he was not too popular because most of the people who would go to the Saw Festival would know more about Home on the Range and Sweet Leilani than they'd know about some of the greater atonal composers.
Because all they made was a lot of horrible noises. He didn't play a tune. Hell no. It hurt your ears to listen to it.
No, I'm hurting your ears.
Hurt a lot of people's ears. I've seen a lot of them wincing.
He was at several of our Saw Festivals. Good fellow. Had a great sense of humor, obviously. Mm-hmm. And there's others around the world right now, but ours was certainly the first.
When they did this, everyone had such a great time. They'd raised the money for the statue and said, let's keep this going. And my grandfather, Charlie Blacklock, who had studied with Tom Scribner and been a friend of his and learned saw playing from him, said, you know, we've got to keep this thing going.
There's an old spinning wheel in the parlor.
The first festival was 1978. I played at it because I was in Charlie's Blacklock's band, and Charlie's band played that festival. The festival was run by the people that started it, Ruth Bratton and other people in the radio station, the first 3 or 4 years.
About the musical saw, it goes back 100 years, way back in early vaudeville in the 1800s. Probably started about 2 weeks after somebody invented the saw. Somebody with a real saw realized that, gee, if you just take a saw and if it's tight, you can do it with your hand. And so somebody else probably figured out, gee, if you can do that with your thumb. That's the way I started playing. And some people still play it with their thumb. People use various kinds of bows. This is an old violin bow that I've had for many, many, many years. Also, of course, the vibrating knee is very, very important to give you the give you the wah-wah sound, the tremolo. Some people don't use it. Some people don't. They play it straight and just go straight for the notes. But the majority of people do use the tremolo wobbling effect.
These people were probably poor. They couldn't afford a pedal steel, so saw worked just as well, you know.
Doesn't have the quality of a stringed instrument. It's just this odd thing that came about. You know, oh, there's a saw, you know, he's a worker, and they use that tool to make music. It's just fascinating.
It had this really neat, natural, almost eerie sound to it, and it was perfect for country music.
My dad played music all my life. It wasn't no stranger to me. And everybody else was, what in the world is that?
I've been playing it since my first year of college back in Buffalo, New York, because nobody else did. So I was almost automatically, and almost always the best in the world because nobody ever heard anybody else play. Then I moved to Santa Cruz. Tom played a lot, played quite often down here on Pacific Avenue. Like a lazy ocean, ugly
shore. He was a street musician when I first knew him. He was playing out on the streets. And I used to sit there and watch him play for hours, you know. He was so good, you know.
Just out there on the mall. He'd be sitting there in the window with his hat out to catch all of the money. I don't know how much he made, but he never starved to death, as far as I know.
I talk with a lot of folks who have lived in Santa Cruz for a long time who remember Mr. Scribner and remember him playing out here on Pacific Avenue and playing for kids in schools and such, and very, very giving of his time. So he's still much beloved in town.
I remember Scribner when I was a kid. He used to come in and play with his grandson at our elementary school, Natural Bridges. And then we'd come down here and say, oh, that's Mr. Scribner. And what a neat deal.
I used to know this guy when I was 10 years old, coming down here to listen to him with my grandmother.
He wore this derby. You know, and he was a kind of a slight man, and he was always in a suit, and you know, he'd cross his leg, because you had to put the saw in between your knee and your thigh. He'd just get it in there, and then he'd just take that violin bow, and he'd play these melodies that you'd recognize. And so he would be playing, you know, downtown. He was like a fixture for, it seemed like forever down there. There's a statue of him there now downtown, and it's
he's a picture. That he was just regular as the sunrise down there.
It was kind of a golden age down in the Santa Cruz Mall. He was a delight. He was a treat, a reason to go downtown to go see Tom.
I think it's great when they made that statue and put it up of him. Yeah, he had that coming. And he's still there.
Everybody else has opinions about the statue, but Tom's opinion was he was just flabbergasted by it. This is from Tom. Here in Santa Cruz, some people are erecting a statue of me playing the musical saw. Ordinarily, a statue would show a man on a horse with a sword. That bronze is supposed to last 5,000 years. I can just visualize someone in the future asking, what is that man doing? Well, he's playing a musical saw. What's a saw? Well, that's something you cut wood with. What's wood? So perchance, if you are around Santa Cruz, you will see a statue of a man wearing a derby hat and playing the musical saw in one hand and holding the Communist Manifesto in the other. That will be me, Tom Scribner.
Well, I first met Tom probably 1967, 1968 at the original Old Catalyst. Tom had come in the afternoons and have a beer and hold court sometimes. Every once in a while, Tom would get up and play the saw. He'd regale us with stories about his wobbly days. He was a union organizer for the lumber camps.
So he was quite a character of, in his younger days, very political. There were a lot of musicians involved with the Wobblies. Woody Guthrie, Pete Seeger. Tom would speak fondly of them.
Remember when we honored him at Nelson Center? You were there?
Yeah, sure.
And I appreciated Tom for being my favorite anti-imperialist.
How many people in this room who know who Tom Scribner was?
I could tell Tom Scribner stories for about the next day and a half, I think. It was Scribner's crazy idea. Let's start a musical saw festival. This year is the 39th annual musical saw festival.
I never forget the man. He's really, in my mind, famous.
My cousin David Weiss was the principal oboist of the LA Philharmonic for 30 years, and he knew and performed with Tom Scribner.
And I'm wishing I could be responsive.
Tom Scribner.
There it is.
Leon Russell, Jerry Miller, George Harrison. Tom Scribner.
Tom Scribner.
All the big ones.
All the noteworthy musicians of that era.
But George played the slide, the dobro, and he sang a song with him.
Wishing I could ain't the answer, whether I should ain't the question.
Tom said, I've been down with recording with the Beatles. Most of it was done in Hollywood, Capitol Tower.
That's a big deal, especially in that time period. The Capitol was like, the Beatles were there.
Frank Sinatra.
Frank Sinatra.
Nat King Cole.
The greats.
He was happy. He enjoyed it a lot. You know, it was a big deal. I think a lot of it just went over his head about how famous that place was. We're going to Los Angeles. He's going to make records with the Beatles. But Tom was a Studio A. He was a big star. Nobody had ever seen a musical saw before. Tom played on a song called Wishing I Could. I don't know why, but we picked that. Maybe we just played some songs and he says, I can do that. That's probably how it went. Tom was good on it too.
He was the master. He got that thing to sound really neat and eerie and spooky and, and I don't know, he put some feeling into it,
But in Wishing I Could, the saw is such a unique instrument. It made it tearful. It fit great.
Jerry Miller, we had him come down. He played on a couple of things. Yeah, Moby Jerry.
Jerry Miller Band, a living legend from Monterey International Pop Festival.
We had Moby Grape at first, the Jerry Miller Band at the back room. And we played some little ones along the Pacific Garden Mall. And all of these people that were just essence of Santa Cruz at the time. Scribner, I recorded with him. We went down to LA and recorded at the Capitol with Larry on Crosswords album. That was really nice. Ken Kesey, he was the host of a poetry festival. Scribner was part of it somehow. This is poetry. And Kesey was cool, he knew I was introverted and sitting all by myself, and he came over and he discovered I knew a song called The Frozen Lager. He says, well, that's practically the anthem here, in state anthem in Oregon. So we sat there and sang The Frozen Lager, me and Kesey and Tom Scribner.
Welcome everyone to the 39th Annual International Musical Saw Festival!
My father was Charlie Blackbaum, and my grandmother was Viola. We were raised with his saw playing and music. We're kind of a family that likes music, and I'd say all my siblings are musicians, and all my cousins are musicians, and of course we're teaching our children.
Mm-hmm.
I'm Charlie Blacklock's son. My father was a street musician. He played Ghirardelli Square and Telegraph Avenue.
Now, Charlie and Viola, they really instilled in all their kids and their grandchildren a love of music.
Teaching our children, so the great-grandchildren are playing. But coming here, just jam. And that's what I grew up with, was jamming with the grandfather. It's like a family reunion. We just make a point to save the date.
I started playing the saw when I was 14 years old. I discovered the bow probably in 1980 when I saw David Weissman, the oboist for the Philharmonic. He was playing it with a bow and I said, darn, isn't that cool? Because you could really make those notes sing. Saw I play was our saw. In fact, it was our household saw. It's the one I still play.
There you have it.
The saw I'm playing today is a regular carpenter saw called a sharp tooth. I started violin when I was 7 years old, then decided I wanted to learn to play the saw. I learned from a book called Scratch My Back, written by a saw player. I taught sixth graders to play it. We made it part of our science class as to why saw would sing. I like to play hymns. It feels like I'm singing when I play it.
To our home on God's celestial shore, I'll fly away.
When I was about 6 years old, my father was taking me with him to the hardware store that was down on Pacific, and I heard this beautiful sound. And so that's when I first met Tom and Charlie. That was the beginning of it. I had to get a saw. Now, I never learned how to use the bow very well, so I always just sort of plink and plunk it with my fingers.
I came to Santa Cruz in 1979. When I first arrived in town, I saw this sculpture of a saw player. So I studied this statue quite carefully and then walked on down the street and there was Tom Scribner sitting and playing the saw.
Yeah, I feel quite indebted to Tom Scribner because he showed me his technique.
Well, once I found out that this festival happened, I was just sort of intrigued. Every year I'd think, oh, well, there it goes again. And that's happened 34 times since I met Tom Scribner. Tom Scribner gave me a lot. And so that's a reason that I came back. In the hour or so that I was with him, He showed me how to play the saw, and I've gone on to do a lot of saw playing.
I get the big sessions in Australia as a saw player.
You know, if you're in Santa Cruz, wander by that statue. You know, Thomas Spirits, who is here today?
Oh, yeah.
He plays there. That's what he does.
I wasn't inspired to play the musical saw until 1994. So I sent away for a musical saw, set about teaching myself how to play, and here I am now. My other marketable skill. The street ambiance, the beep beeps of the trucks and the horns and such, it becomes an orchestral thing out here. It's a background for the musical saw and vice versa.
Thank you very much. See, you get the whole ambiance. You get somewhere over the rainbow, you get the trucks, I get free half a sandwich. This is, thank you very much, sir.
Here's a script.
they're both about the same. This whole thing can be an inspiration to anyone for any reason at all, then I feel like I'm serving some sort of purpose. It's nice to do something that people enjoy and that takes them, you know, stirs pleasant memories for them.
And so we still honor Tom Scribner every year as part of our tradition by meeting at the statue and gathering around it and playing musical saw. And even to this day, there are people that remember him and knew him, and it's a lot of fun.
Oh, great homes that I used to wrap, it's a new chariot home, singing old, them golden slippers home, them golden slippers home, since I'm going, cause I look so neat.
I've played for 39 years. I've played in China and Hong Kong and in Japan. I like it because it's a small instrument, it's flexible, it's an easy instrument to play. I like the voice of it. You know, it's a clean sound if you can do it well. The last couple of years of Tom's life, I was able to meet with him and talk with him. I mean, I became a serious saw player after that. He gave me a nice recommendation. He said I was the best saw playing he'd heard of since 1922 or something like that.
When I was in Taiwan studying Chinese and Chinese art, one day while I was biking, I heard this unusual sound that I'd never heard before. So I followed the sound and found a man who would play the saw. Ever since I first heard the sound of the saw, I've enjoyed making that sound.
No two saw players really sound alike. I enjoy it because it's sort of abstract. Unexpected performances, all around a good time.
Lou Manick has been to the festival and he's bragging how much fun it was and how great it was, what a good experience. So I said, I'll go this summer. I think I'm going to be a regular.
Thank you.
Yeah. This community, it comes out of the mists once a year, and then this wonderful thing happens, and then it just evaporates again, and then magically reappears the next year. Love it.
My favorite part of the whole Saw Festival is the jam session in the parking lot on Saturday nights. That's where we get really raucous.
I have never been around, in all that time, another serious saw player, if you could say there is such a thing as a serious saw player. So I've been wanting to come here for several years.
When I die, hallelujah, bye and bye, and I will fly away.
So this is my first time, and it's great. It's wonderful being here.
It's a great pleasure being here with you people. I can't tell you how great it feels. Thank you.
He's affected the course of my life and my music career. So I've thought about him a lot, and it's really great to come back and be with you people.
Just awesome, and I love the sound of musical saw being played, as well as it is around here. There are some really fine saw players. I'm not one of them, but
yeah,
it rubs off.
We need more saw players.
Kenny was talking about the 60 saw players that showed up in New York, I figured that's probably the entire world population.
I do not predict any wild worldwide thing going for the musical saw. It's been around, it's been played for 100 years or more. It hasn't quite caught on yet.
It was a good touch, added to the eccentricity of Santa Cruz. It was eccentric.
Keep Santa Cruz weird.
and one of the originals. Did you ever try to play a musical saw, by the way?
No. Can you give me any tips?
Put it between your legs. I think you cross your legs and you bend the saw. And you saw the, not the sharp end, the flat side.
Okay.
And you twist and change the pitch by moving the saw blade.
You can see this is smaller here. So I gotta play higher. But I'm not going to get as low as this saw. Getting some high overtones there. So now I'm doing the same thing. I'm pushing, I'm pulling. So you see how much pressure I'm pushing?
Not as much as I was, right?
Exactly.